following is a video presentation of an evening worship service at Orrville Baptist Church.
Thank you. figure that we came up with was at 10:45 this morning. The number was 5,650,450 people that had perished in the year 2017. I just looked at it right before I came up here. Just an update from that moment that we looked this morning to right now, over 50,000 people have now since passed from that time until right now. In the world, over 50,000. You hear that, and it's just staggering. It is absolutely staggering to know that it's literally every breath that we take, someone from this world is gone. And it harkens back to understand Ecclesiastes. It makes it much more clear. Life is just and by the second, people are passing away and people are dying. That should stir something up within us as a corporate body, as a global church as well. And we have a great mission before us. We have much to do, much work to do. We are not close. We have a lot of work to do. From time to time, I will probably announce those numbers just to keep us in check and to keep our minds focused on the reality. It's easy to gather together and in this moment, you know, kind of brush it off. And when you hear the number out loud, it brings reality to a forefront. Something that we have to remember and something that we're forced to look at and understand. So I think it's healthy for us to keep that in mind from time to time, and we'll do that. Tonight, we continue. This one does not, we can call them bumper sticker verses. The ones that we read, and sometimes they don't really mean what we think they mean, or really not even what we think they mean, the way they're presented, it's kind of off base a little bit. Tonight is one that I would not argue is a bumper sticker verse. I don't really see this on coffee mugs and on portraits or bumper stickers or anything like that. But yet I hear it a lot. And it's not one that I hear. I would not say that I hear it from the local church pulpit very often. I would say it's one that I hear a lot on from television. As a result, many people hear this message and they walk away thinking the wrong thing. It is found in the book of Matthew chapter 21. Matthew chapter 21, verse 22. There are many verses that are similar in nature. Mark contains this account. John has this verse and they worded slightly different. But Matthew 21:22, if you have your Bible, you can follow or simply listen. It says the following: "And all things you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive." I have heard that countless times perusing the TV channels, and popular speakers are on, and they will mention that verse, and they'll say, "See, all you must do is ask. All that you must do is ask in prayer, but you must believe. You must believe that what you want will be given to you. If you pray hard enough and you have enough faith and you believe, you will receive it." That televangelist is absolutely correct. The problem with the televangelist saying that in that way is he's usually speaking about what we have railed against already: cars, raises, money, material wealth, material gain. And yet that's not at all what is being presented. Matthew 21, verse 22 is a part of a larger section of Scripture, a very, very familiar passage that we've learned about throughout Sunday school growing up, if you've been in the church long enough. I'm not going to spend, I'll be honest, the time that this text deserves. I think this deserves hours of preaching. But if you start at verse 21 and look at what has brought us here, do you have a heading in your Bible for chapter 21? Mine says the triumphal entry. Something we've read about as well. Jesus coming into Jerusalem. And how is he welcomed? How is it that Jesus is welcomed into Jerusalem at the great triumphal entry? Someone tell me, how is he received? Well, bad.
Blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord.
There you go.
Destroying all things, shouting for God.
It is, as we've been talking about worship in this series on Sunday mornings, you come to this section and you hear what Mike just announced. I look forward to the day in which we do that to our King.
Amen.
I look forward to the day in which we bow and we are the ones laying down the branches and shouting Hosanna. And shouting, worthy is he. And singing choruses about the Lamb that was slain who is standing before us. I look forward to that day. And in a strange way here in chapter 21, you see that actualized. You see it realized. You see Christ coming in and the reverence and the worship placed before him and the most saddest part about this section of Scripture is that it's empty. Many people would lay down palm branches and would shout Hosanna and welcome him with great open arms and thanksgiving, only to shout crucify him. Many of the same hands would be placed on the ground before him, exalting him, worshiping him, would betray him. On the other hand, we remember that Israel was looking for their military king, their political king, and for that reason they bowed down to him. And it's at this moment Jesus also, in a sense, unveils himself as spiritual king, the true king who has come into the world. I find it very interesting that at verse 10, because when he entered Jerusalem, all the city was stirred, saying, who is this? And the crowds were saying, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee. And then you go to verse 12, one of my favorite scenes in Scripture. I'm just going to go ahead and read. Just follow along or listen if you like. But I'd like to just go take a moment to read. Immediately after being entered in, and welcomed in, we read the following. And Jesus entered the temple and drove out all those who were buying and selling in the temple and overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who were selling doves. And he said to them, it is written, my house shall be a house of prayer, but you are making it a robber's den. And the blind and the lame came to him in the temple and he healed them. But when the chief priests and the scribes saw the wonderful things that he had done, and the children were shouting in the temple, Hosanna to the Son of David! They became indignant and said to him, do you hear what these children are saying? And Jesus said to them, yes, have you never read, out of the mouth of infants and nursing babies, you have prepared praise for yourself. And he left them and went out to the city of Bethany and spent the night there. Welcomed in, and this big parade is made for our King, who's finally walking into Jerusalem. People are excited and happy. And as King, his first duty is not to go and throw a revolt or a revolution. His first decree as King is not to go and overthrow the government and establish socioeconomic powers and bring economic justice to his people. His first decree is to walk into the temple, overturn the tables and shout, my house shall be called a house of prayer, to rid the church of the infection that was currently there, greed, scandal, money. These are the elements that were running the temple. And Jesus, after being inaugurated in, what does he do? He just walks in and just flails the people out. And then we get to that wonderful scene starting in verse 18, which contains the verse we talked about earlier, verse 22. And so what I'd like to do is just kind of go by a little bit by a little bit. There's no 3 points. There are no big sections I want us to section off tonight. I just want to talk about what we just learned, what Jesus has just done. That last verse that we read, verse 22, about anything you say in prayer and ask, if you believe, you get it. And then this in-between section, starting in verse 18. Now in the morning when he was returning to the city, he became hungry. We've said this before, too. People will ask, who is this Jesus? Who is this man? And we know him as God. And yet, here's another example of his humanity. Fully God, fully man. He became hungry. And seeing a long fig tree by the road, he came to it and found nothing on it except leaves only. And he said to it, no longer shall there ever be any fruit for you. And at once, the fig tree withered. You ever wondered why Jesus was so mean to that one fig tree? I had a very difficult time hearing that for the first time as a child. I said, what did the tree ever do to Jesus? I didn't understand it. And if you go read the parallel account in Mark, I was even more confused. When you go to Mark, do you know what it says about the fig tree? It's not even the season for figs. Mark plainly says that. Now it's not even the season for figs to be grown. So why on earth did Jesus, why was he so mad about this? Why did he so upset that he would cause it to wither? No longer shall there ever be any fruit from you. There's something extremely interesting happening about this picture, this one picture. The land was filled with fig trees all over, and yet it says that there's this one fig tree by the road. Seeing a long fig tree by the road, they would usually have a couple. They're not just, it's kind of rare to see just one, not around any others. It reminds me a lot of what we said this morning about the nation of Israel. All the other nations, all the other peoples, all the other tribes, and yet there has been one nation, Israel, that has been called and set apart for his goodness. And then as Jesus is coming along the road, notice this one single fig tree by itself. I don't know why there were leaves on it. If it's not in season, it shouldn't be happening. I'm not real sure what the case for this was. I did not know this until recently. Do we have any fig experts here tonight? I don't like figs, so I don't have much to say about it. Why don't like figs? You like collard greens, don't like figs. So now I can lie and say whatever I want about figs. I was hoping we'd have somebody to verify this. I had no idea. I'm taking the scholar's word for this and the farmer's word for this. The fig tree, the fig actually produces, fig tree produces figs first and then leaves second. I had no idea. News to me. Showed you how much I know about vegetation and gardening, which is not my forte. And so, if there's leaves on this tree, on this fig tree, what should be there? Figs. I don't know if it was a nice soil, water supply I used. I don't know what caused it to grow out of time for it to be producing any kind of leaf or vegetation. I have no clue why, other than to say God's sovereign plan for this moment to happen. But if the leaves come after the figs, naturally there should be figs on this plant, and yet there are none. Jesus sees this and says, no longer shall there ever be any fruit from you. Does this not make what we just read about him going into Jerusalem and then cleaning out the temple And then straight from that, we read this account. There's a reason why God made this happen in succession. There's a lesson for us to learn about why that happened back to back. Jesus is pointing out something to his disciples as well. By the way, Mark's account is a two-day event. Jesus goes one morning, they come back the next morning, and it's withered. Matthew's giving us a very concise account. He's kind of just merging all of this all together at once. Either way, you see a tree that has leaves on it, and you come back the very next day, just one day, and it's completely, not a little, it's completely withered and dead. Do you not look at that and say, how strange? In only one day. How is that possible? The point being that immediately this tree is becoming dead. As soon as he says the words, the tree begins to die. So verse 20, seeing this, the disciples were amazed and asked, how did the fig tree wither all at once? And Jesus answered and said to them, truly I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what was done to the fig tree, but even if you say to this mountain, be taken up and cast into the sea, it will happen. Jesus giving a promise to the disciples. If you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what was done to this fig tree, you'll do more. There's a lot of instances throughout the scriptures about mountains and the weight, the gravity, and the grandeur of mountains. And what it means to be able to pick one up and to simply flip it over is a sign of great majesty and power and might. And yet, Jesus says, if you believe and have faith and do not doubt, you won't just pick the mountain up, you will take it and you will cast it to the very depths of the ocean. That is the power of believing. That is the power of believing in an eternal, perfect, almighty, all-powerful God. That is the God that we serve. And then to end, Jesus says in verse 22, in all things you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive. It's hard for us to come to grips with passages such as this because we don't both do it. But what does he mean there? One of the things I think of when I read verse 21, especially, it says, if you have faith and do not doubt. Do the disciples ever doubt? Absolutely. Do we doubt? Yes. Does God still use us? Yes. I immediately think, when I read that passage, I immediately think of the man who says to Jesus, not be able to finish it for me. He says, Lord, I believe, but help my what? My unbelief. And elsewhere you think about Jesus talking about that little tiny seed. What kind of seed is he talking about? You already know where I'm going with this. A mustard seed. How big is a mustard seed? But what does it grow into? The size, it starts like this. The faith, it starts like this, blossoms into something much more, huge compared to what it began. Absolutely huge compared to where it started. In proportion to what it began as, blossoms into something much, 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 much bigger. I think about that scene. I think about the man who says, I believe, not my unbelief. And Jesus looks at him and sees favor and sees blessing and performs a miracle. And then I come here and it says, and do not doubt. So which is it? And is there a contradiction there? I would argue that God understands the human spirit. He understands the human soul. He understands the human mind, the fallen heart, the heart of one who has to grow and is sanctified, but also needs to grow in sanctification, to grow in Christ-likeness, to grow in faithfulness to God. Having the faith of a mustard seed is not very much, and yet it says you can move mountains. Here's the kicker about faith the size of a mustard seed. It was never intended to stay the size of a mustard seed. That's where we begin. begin our journey. That's where we start off in our journey. Our faith, our belief, our lack of doubt. As we get to enter into this communication, this relationship with the living God, continues to blossom and grow and grow and grow and grow and grow. And it never means anything about asking prayer, believing you will see, you know, whatever you want. Jesus means it will always be in alignment with God's will. Always. The promises of God. In all cases, anytime you seek, you ask for prayer, believing you will see, it is always that you will be praying for the will of God to be done. Every circumstance that you read those kind of mentions in Scripture, it is always, every time we understood that we are praying that God's will would be done. And there's the beauty in that prayer. Because in all things that you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive. I can't promise you, I've said this a thousand times, I can't promise anyone here tonight, including myself, that there's something that I want for my material wealth, and I just believe, and I believe, and I believe hard enough that it will get me that thing that I desire. Because ultimately, that is in God's hands. What we can grab hold to and know without doubt, I mean without a bit of doubt, are the promises of God. I think about an instance, say that I had an illness, a disease. The doctor said that there was not a very good thing. And I said, well, I believe that I will get better. And I will pray that I will get better. And I promise to get better. Am I? I'm not. If God's will is to take me home, God's will be done. However, if I know for a fact where my home is, and in that prayer I ask, God, please, enter me into your kingdom. And enter me into fellowship with my brothers and sisters. And enter me into your gates. And enter me before you at your throne, where I worship you for all eternity. My home that I am completely 100% assured of and know of. I ask all that in prayer and believe it. Will it come true? But yes, because it's a promise of God. It's an absolute promise of God that we have been given salvation. And so there's a parallel that Jesus is making from chapter 21 to chapter 22. You see him brought in. You see him paraded in. You see the reaction from the people. How warmly he received. How it's a glad, happy day. And immediately he sets forth to do God's will, cleansing the temple. An act of authority. An absolute act of authority as king. And as he's reflecting and instructing and teaching his disciples, reflecting on what has just happened to the people who warmly brought him in, and yet he corrected them, we get the picture. There's a strange, yet very potent, I think a very strong illustration to be used with the picture. A very strong illustration about how a fig tree operates and that it produces fruit and then leaves. And then you come across this picture here of this fig tree that, out of season, oddly enough, shows all the signs that fruit will be there, and yet there is no fruit. And so the tree is cursed. Unfortunately, I hate to say it, but even today, Israel still lives under that curse. But they do not know their king. And one day they will. For now, they do not. If you go visit Israel today, you will still see the majority of the same rituals and routines that happen. The people believe will save them. still under that withering. But yet we see that there is a promise for Israel as well. And we know that promise to be true. There is something very, very, very dangerous about a tree that shows that there will be fruit present, yet does not show it. The most dangerous tree you can ever think of. One that promises fruit, has all the dressings, the trappings of producing fruit, and yet there are none to be found. God have mercy on us as an American nationwide church for almost embodying that picture perfectly. No, I don't mean just here at Orrville. I'm talking we have a systemic American church problem. We turn on the lights, and sometimes we have lasers, and we have the trumpet sound, and we have certain instruments signaling, here's the beginning of worship, and we have countdown clocks. Sometimes we have, signals for me to begin. We turn on worship, and then just as soon as we turn it on, we flip it off like a switch, and we all leave home. We have these set arrangements to do this, and to do that, and to do this. And we have programs, we have ministries, we have all these things. They end up being things. And at the end of the day, a lot of times for many of us, both as individuals and as churches, we are doing nothing but showing leaves. And no fruit to be seen. I struggle with this verse because I have felt that way for many years in my personal walk. Saying all the right things. Doing what I believe was all the right things. I am still on that path of learning, even as your pastor. And the sadness is that I'm not alone. I'm not alone by a long shot. And so for many in the church today, that's exactly what we see. Please. Just leaves. My prayer is that God grants us more days. Gives us time, that He has been incredibly patient with us as a people, as a country, as a nation. I'm ready to go home, and at the same time, in a way, I'm begging for mercy for us as a nation. That we would see fruit sprouting abundantly. That we would see fruit coming out of the church abundantly. That we would no longer settle for simply wanting to show our leaves. And that's the sad part. We often delight in just leaves. But look what we've done, God. Look what we've done. Look what we've done. Look what we've done. Look at our name. Look at our stature. And yet yielding no fruit. Burdens me and it saddens me. And for that reason, this is why I mentioned this morning that I wanted us to talk a little bit about not only this, but I also wanted us to have some time of prayer. I've been a little convicted, and I don't do this on purpose. I really don't, but it always ends up on Wednesday night and Sunday nights. The people who come end up getting sneak peeks of what we're doing next. I think I just forget to announce on Sunday mornings, but it's not intentional. We conclude a Spirit and Truth series today. Next Sunday, starting Sunday morning, we're going to go through the book of Acts. I think it's very appropriate for us to go through the book of Acts. To see what the church did and where it, quote, unquote, began. To see this disciple-making process take place and this call for the gospel to just explode. I'm looking forward to us going through that together as a church. And one of the verses I wanted to bring up, and this kind of hit me, there's many like it. It comes from the book of Acts, chapter 2, verse 42, one simple verse. We even spoke about it in one of our sermons about the role of the church. But chapter 2, verse 42 says this: they were continually devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. There are other declarations of what the church is throughout the scriptures, and some of them even say that dedicating and devoting and committed to the prayers. The prayers. And it's interesting to me because it's always meant in a corporate aspect. It's in a corporate setting that they do this. And I kind of mentioned it at the very beginning of this, that we usually will start with a prayer. We have a closing prayer, and we're content with that. Now, every time we gather, we can't be here. I understand. We could. We can. We're not going to be here for 5 hours. So we're not going to spend an hour and a half in prayer, and then, well, if it's me preaching, another hour and a half preaching. I know it won't end up. But there's going to be some times where, as a church together, I would like for us to just simply go to God in prayer. I'm truly burdened by what we read in Scripture about this. And so what we've asked to do tonight, very specific prayers. If you were here this morning, I mentioned David saying a prayer Wednesdays ago that was, I consider, very bold and dangerous in a good way. Very thankful. I think from time to time here at Orrville, we should have moments where we gather. And I think we should have specific things on our minds. Specific things that we should pray for. In conjunction with this morning, I'd like for us to spend a few minutes tonight praying for our next step as a church together. For where we go from here. For what now? I don't know about you, but going through this series on Spirit and Truth has awakened something in me. It has pierced my heart in a very good way. It has crushed me. I'm convinced that we need to step up. I need to step up in disciple making. I personally. Now, I already have, and I will continue to repent for the ways in which I have failed God in that area. I believe that is where we go next. That number is growing by the minute. By the second, that number is increasing and increasing and increasing. I hope that we can make long-term plans. I'm not going to speak out of turn with the deacons here. Tommy, I apologize. I'm not making any decrees right here from the pulpit tonight. I pray that we can do great, great things. Every year, possibly increase the budget by 1% to missions. There's some things that we can do. We can make great sacrifices for. I want us to pray tonight that we would have the courage to take part in that, to see radical, I mean absolutely radical blessing happen here, right here at Orrville. Remember why we asked that blessing from this morning. We will boldly go to God, boldly approach His throne, and ask Him to bless us that we may bless others. Never for ourselves. Never to feel good. Never to feel better. Never to feel like we're stronger Christians. In every case, pleading with God to bless us so that we may be a light to other people. I believe in the promises of God, and I believe that if we do that, I truly believe we will see amazing things happen within our body. I firmly believe that. I'm committed to it. I'm committed to it with you.
Thank you for watching this presentation from Orrville Baptist Church in Anderson. We hope that you can join us on Sundays for Bible study at 9:45 a.m., morning worship at 11 a.m., evening worship at 6 p.m., and on Wednesdays at 6:30 p.m. May the Lord Jesus Christ bless you and keep you as you go forward this week.